starlight, star bright. First star I've seen tonight. I wish I may. I wish I might. Have the wish I wish tonight.
Ladies and gentlemen, we bring you this special radio television broadcast in order to give you the very latest information on an amazing phenomenon.
I remember I was in West 4th Street, and I suddenly saw this wacky little character just among the crowd. And, you know, you talk about stopping traffic, and it had that kind of effect. And it was amazing, and everybody just stopped and turned. It was sort of like, what the fuck is that, you know? I think I said to you, people said, like, what is that? Not who is that?
And it was very mysterious, austere. It was alien.
This is a cartoon. This is not a reality. And, you know, say, are you sure this guy exists?
It was like a car crash. You could not look away. You were staring at this thing going, what the hell is going on? Does this mean something? Is this art? Is this guy crazy? But you were so fascinated.
He's a person that was on this adventure, and he went on the adventure, and it showed him this glorious thing, and then he died.
Those of us who came to New York came here because we did not fit in to where we grew up. We were misfits, and the only place misfits could go was New York City and find other misfits and then just go wild. And I think we were all fueled by Andy Warhol. We were all very well acquainted with his scene. So I think a lot of us came here and become stars, but on our own terms, on our own turf.
At the time when everybody was arriving and starting up, everybody was in the same boat. Nobody had any money. Everybody was eating, you know, pizza and donuts, and, you know, there just wasn't, it wasn't about success. Everyone had the dream, but it just felt like we're here for a while together, and it was actually a really great kind of camaraderie that you have when there's no threat that someone's going to do better than you. It was actually, everyone was just exploding with creativity, and everyone was supporting each other, and it was really art for art's sake.
And there he was, this little strange man from Berlin. He was staying with a friend, but he needed an apartment, so I set him up in this house on Carmine Street.
We lived on the ground floor, and we had a garden, so, you know, people came to see him, came to see me. I mean, it was a little scene, and it was nice. And he was German, and we, you know, spoke German when we wanted to.
I had seen Klaus around the neighborhood, and he looked sort of like a German exchange student, very conservative looking, and very neatly combed. So he came, and we worked really on his tenor voice, which was lovely, and I used the falsetto, which was obviously there, to help the top of the tenor voice. But he was really interested in working the falsetto, and I just thought he'd end up brokenhearted because there was no context for using your falsetto voice those days. There was no countertenor career, which is huge now in Baroque opera. There was no way really to use it except for kind of private sport and fun.
Yeah, he could sing a little, but yeah. I didn't know what direction that could have taken. I mean, it was obscure, you know. Sometimes he was singing like Maria Callas and pretending to be Maria Callas, or he was like, you know, David Bowie. So it jumped. I thought he was doing what I was doing when I was seven, you know, playing around. And I was, you know, I had a smirk on my face when I saw him doing that. I never thought that would put him out there.
It's newer than new, it's youer than you, it's nower than now, and it's wower than wow.
1978, I played in a rock band called Come On. And I remember at one point, my friend George and I, George was the guitar player, were sitting in Kiev in the East Village, having our breakfast, and we noticed a flyer on the wall. So I thought, that looks interesting. Maybe we should check this out. George looks at me and goes, I think that's a lot of crazy people. I don't think we should get mixed up in that. But one thing led to another, and I took the number, and I ended up calling them.
And welcome to the Irving Plaza Vaudeville Theater in Manhattan. And I know you've traveled far and wide, from California, Ohio, Indianapolis. And you're all here for a special reason. It's because you're marvelous and wonderful and interesting and creative. And welcome!
Well, the vaudeville show was like the traditional vaudeville show, except using new wave acts. We put ads up on posters around town asking for Egyptian slaves, B-girl hostesses, robot monsters, geeks, Nazis, emotional cripples, and assembled this group of, you know, crazies from the club scene.
So I remember we made some guitars out of foam rubber, and they were all painted up, and they pretty much looked like guitars, except they flopped all over the place. And we realized if we scrunched these up, we could get them into attaché cases. So we go on stage, the attaché case would open up, the guitars would pop out. That was our show. We also thought at the time that this is really lame, this is just stupid. We didn't think this was going to fly at all. But it turned out it was one of the hits of the show. So we were in.
One night, I was at Max's with my then boyfriend, Peter, and we were leaving about 1:30 in the morning, and we ran into Klaus. Peter introduced me to him. And out of nowhere, Klaus just got up on this mound of dirty, disgusting New York accumulated snow and started singing this aria from an opera. And I was stunned. It was just this magical moment where the streets were completely deserted, as they used to be back then. And there was Klaus standing under this spotlight on this mound of filthy snow, singing this beautiful piece of music. And it was just such a magical moment. He really seemed like a creature from another dimension. And since I was thinking about talent for the vaudeville show, I said, you've got to be on our show.
Everybody else in the New Wave vaudeville show was charming, inept, funny. They were all kind of like in this community where they were palling around together, doing the sort of like punk version of Mickey Rooney. We're going to do a goofy show.
Oh, I feel the logo coming on now. And it feels really, really good.
Stuff that you could slap yourself on the back and say you're kind of hip because we're doing this outsider theater. And then Klaus came on and it was a whole different level of accomplishment to me. It wasn't silly. It could be perceived as silly because of the way he looked as this kind of gnomish creature, but he was so convincing and his voice was so beautiful. And I do remember, you know, David McDermott, after the first performance, every performance he had to come out and say, this is not an electrical recording. He's actually singing, because people didn't believe it was him.
Thank you.
what I used to do is I would be backstage directing and stage managing and peeking out of the curtains to see how the audience was reacting to certain acts. And then when Klaus went on, I would leave the stage and go around to the back of the theater, go up the stairs to the balcony to look down and see Klaus perform and watch the audience. It was always so exciting because all these young rock and rollers who are pretty cynical would just become like statues, just stunned. Even, it's going to sound a little sentimental, but I remember crying. It was just such a great moment of theater to see the audience being so stunned and astonished. And that was always, I think, the pinnacle of success, is to leave people absolutely speechless.
Song and it changes your life, but I think that's the miracle. People saw him different, or they saw him for the first time. Klaus Sperber was left behind really quick. I mean, he became a very artificial personality. And I think he needed to do that.
Ich habe schon als Kind angefangen. Ich habe immer am Radio gesessen und Radio gehört, als ich klein war, und war immer sehr interessiert, meistens an Sängern natürlich. Das war das Wichtigste für mich. Und wie ich zum ersten Mal eine Opernsängerin gehört habe, da habe ich gedacht, mein Gott, so möchtest du auch mal singen.
In der Familie hier in Essen ist sehr viel gesungen worden immer. Und auch wenn er zu mir kam, hat er mal gesungen. Sagen wir mal, die Mimik und alles versuchte er natürlich nachzumachen. Ne? Und natürlich mussten ja auch immer die Schallplatten her vom Taschengeld. Ja, und da haben wir dann auch immer mitgeholfen ein bisschen. Sie dürfen nicht vergessen, das war ja alles Nachkriegszeit. Er wollte ein Opernstar werden. Er wollte echt singen. Das war wohl der Hauptgrund, warum er nach Berlin gegangen ist, zur Musikhochschule. Und hat dann aber, um sein Taschengeld aufzubessern, in der Deutschen Oper diese Platzanweiserstellung bekommen, sodass er dann jeden Abend dem Opernhaus nahe war. Die Erwartungen waren natürlich größer als das, was auf ihn zugekommen ist. Denn Sie können sich ja denken, ein Junge, der erstmal von Essen nach Berlin geht und dann dieser Übergang Berlin-New York, diese Vorstellungen und Träume, dass da natürlich ein Dämpfer kam erstmal, das ist ja ganz erklärlich.
Fußboden geschrubbt und Tellerwäscher und naja, wie sagt man, die klassische Geschichte. Und das habe ich dann eine Weile gemacht, und bis ich dann langsam aber sicher eine Idee bekam und mein Weg sich langsam bahnte.
Anya Phillips, who at that point was managing the Contortions, she said, "We saw Klaus in that show. You should just put together a band for him." And it is sort of like indicative of the time that I didn't suddenly go like, "Well, I don't know him," or, you know, "Who do you think I am to put together a band for this guy?" It was just like everybody seemed friendly and would just jump at the chance to do some silly new project.
Eventually, I got a phone call from Christian Hoffman, and he said, "Look, I have an idea to just put together a rock show for Klaus, and we'll present it at Max's Kansas City. I've booked a gig there. Do you want to play drums? So I thought, okay, that sounds like fun. I'll do that. So we went to Max's, and this was a lark. This was just a joke. But it was a very minimal setup. I think we had a Hawaiian lap guitar up on a stand, which we had Klaus play in a break. Klaus has no idea how to play, but it didn't matter. It just, he started making noise and it looked good. We had two dancers who were both wrapped head to toe in saran wrap, which looked great. The light kicking off it, they looked like some sort of mummies from outer space. Although later backstage, I realized that they were suffocating. But that was it.
His look was so specific, and I thought the band is going to look like a bunch of jerks behind him. So I thought, like, well, what if we have the band on purpose look like they're not really part of the scene? So I decided that we should wear either ski masks or, like, ultra suede face masks like Texas Chainsaw Massacre, something to disguise us. So it's sort of, you would see this very ethereal, refined elfin creature out in front. And in the back, you'd see these people that you weren't quite sure what they were doing there. You couldn't project a personality on them because you couldn't see their face, if you looked at them at all. And so that was pretty funny for the first couple gigs. And then, of course, we got tired of it because it was hot and uncomfortable, and we realized nobody was looking at us anyway.
I remember we come to the end of the first song and stop, and there's a pregnant pause, and then the place just goes crazy. And at that moment, I realized this isn't just a joke. There's something really here.
And I found this apartment on 9th Street, and it was great, facing this courtyard with all these trees. And it just so happened that Klaus was on St. Mark's facing the courtyard. And, you know, one of the best memories of living there was his constant rehearsing and singing, filling the courtyard. You know, it was amazing. You know, you just come up to the apartment, you know, and especially in the summer when all the windows were open, and there he would be just singing away, and it would just resonate through everything, and it was pretty wonderful. I invited him to come over to my apartment and see my paintings.
Oh, good, I'm expecting you.
Hello, good evening. My name is Nomi. Good evening.
Hello.
And now you have to die.
I remember them coming over and being floored themselves by the imagery and what I was working on, which was the new wave fantasy, the dream of going to outer space of the 60s continued. And then they decided right then and there that I was a Nomi as well. Nomis were from outer space, and they were very pointed. They had sharp new wave angles, and it was basically a kind of a club, a secret society of people that were ready to embrace this fantasy. You know, most of those 50s science fiction films were about some radioactivity getting loose and growing, or the Martians coming down and wreaking havoc. It was basically, it was always about the end of the world. So we all believed that the end of the world was imminent. It's like, it's all gonna fall apart now, so we better just live it up right now. When our Earth was destroyed, we would be having even more fun in outer space. It would be better.
Now that we've done the gig at Max's, we're realizing this is a real show. We have to do something. Christian came up with four or five songs, and a friend of ours was an engineer at Electric Lady Studios in New York. So he would sneak us in late at night, and we'd lay down tracks there. At one point, Ron Johnson, who was the head engineer, came by to see what we were doing, and he took one look at this and thought, I ought to be in on this.
So when I went to Max's, I was, I think I was accompanied by Paige. We got out of a cab, I believe, or whatever it was. Looking around the streets, it was jammed with people. And I said, what is this? And they, and Paige said, it's the people waiting to get in to see Klaus. I said, you're kidding. The surprise that I had at Max's was that I may have been a little bit in shock, but I swear to God, it was something that I not only hadn't ever seen, but could not figure out. And people were just sort of dumbfounded, as if they had come to see a freak. And it seemed like everybody was interested in this freak. Consequently, I thought there was a tremendous potential for building a whole event out of that character, whatever that character was.
So Ron and I started talking, and we became Klaus's de facto managers. Ron basically took care of the music, I took care of the visuals, the show.
About the Samson and Delilah aria that was the first thing that I or anybody else saw him do was that that was in a theater, the Irving Plaza, where everybody was sitting down. But that is really different from the atmosphere in most of the rock or disco clubs at the time, where people would be chattering and rattling their cocktail glasses and, you know, going into the bathroom with their drug dealer or whatever. So we did think with the band it was really important to be able to get the audience's attention before we could get them to come down to the moment of being available to the true beauty of Klaus's accomplishments. And that's why we used the pop hook of Lightning Strikes. I also love that song, and I did think it was a pop song that would take advantage of Klaus's range.
Ich hatte immer den Zwiespalt zwischen Oper und Pop. Nicht? Als Kind habe ich Platten gekauft, ich habe Geld gestohlen von meiner Mama, wofür sie hoffentlich mir vergeben hat, und habe Elvis Presley King Creole gekauft. Und dann hat sie, war sie so wütend darüber, weil sie konnte Rock'n'Roll nicht ausstehen. So hat sie die Platte genommen und Maria Callas gekauft anstelle. Und dann natürlich, da war ich wieder zwischen den Elementen.
Fiorucci was definitely the happening spot.
It was the hippest store. You know, it was so fancy, none of us could afford anything there at all. We just go and look. And most of us worked there, actually. They said it was like an audition for a Fellini movie. Down to the ground.
Joey Arias was the kind of the maitre d'hotel and would meet and greet everybody and look incredible all the time. We just tried to keep as much excitement perpetuated as we could. So we would keep the store open for 24-hour periods at a time. We would do live windows. We tried to involve performance artists and artists. It seemed at the time to be extremely the right thing to be doing.
when Joey and Klaus saw the paintings, Joey said, oh, I gotta get you a show at Fiorucci. And then to top it off, Klaus was gonna perform at the show. And it was called Fiorucci Celebrates the New Wave.
Built a stage in the middle of the store that you could see from within the store if you were lucky enough to get in the store, or from outside on 59th Street. And we built a set, which is the big Klaus Nomi N, covered in striped vinyl with a door in it. And I think there was a spotlight shined on the door, the door open, and Klaus walking sideways through the door because his shoulders were so wide, because they were so padded, appeared and started his act. The name Nomi was such an unusual name that we wanted to kind of create a logo around it. In fact, I believe his silhouette in the spotlight that evening actually became the Klaus Nomi logo. He had this sort of an inverted V-shaped hairdo, and we put him in a tuxedo that was heavily padded in the shoulders. And I think when everybody saw his silhouette in the spotlight, immediately it looked like the Batman logo up in shining on the clouds.
And it was transporting, and everybody suddenly, slowly shut up. And bit by bit, suddenly you're not in Fiorucci, you're not anywhere. Witness kind of like, you know, this is art, you know, and you are not.
Klaus was the person I would describe as having been camera ready. I mean, I was trying to see everything in black and white in those days. Seeing Klaus in black and white was easy. He had rendered himself into black and white. I think that Klaus was the first person I'd ever met who had been chemically treated so that he would become black and white. Well, when I first met Klaus, that was the first thing I was really impressed with, his level of androgyny. Not just the androgyny of the sexuality, but the androgyny of whether you're human or not. I mean, this was an androgyny beyond androgyny, where he became robot-like. This was the spontaneity that wasn't going to be spontaneous. This was the wild new wave experience that was going to be tightly controlled. There was definitely a sense that I was up against a surface, a very interesting surface, very well-designed surface, but a surface that I wasn't going to go into, and it was never going to become photography concerning itself with any human behavior.
Could I still
I interviewed him because I just didn't get it. I didn't know what it was about, and I couldn't understand it, and I genuinely wanted to know. He was so done and so put together, and it was this wrong guy in the wrong place doing the wrong thing, and everything was all wrong, you know? And I wanted to know if he was being, like, totally ironic, or if he was even in on the joke. I mean, did he get it? Yeah, and although he was obviously a great exhibitionist and loved everybody looking at him as he walked down the street, so, I mean, he had that aspect to him which didn't particularly endear me to him. It's like, come on, you know, time out now, you know. We're two guys talking here. You don't have to dress like this. But then after talking to him for a while, you realize the overwhelming feeling was just what a sweet person, you know, what a nice guy. It was just nice to sit in his apartment, which is an ordinary little place, and watch him being an ordinary guy, but he was never really very ordinary. He realized that it was a wonderful act that he had, and to put a sort of a rather flippant and superficial side to something was actually very, he felt very deeply. So it was nice that there was this sort of dichotomy. Deep down, he was very superficial. No, on the surface, he was very profound. Or whatever. But yeah, it all made sense somehow.
Ladies and gentlemen, David Bowie.
Klaus had created a lot of attention, you know, in the downtown scene. And thankfully, it got to Bowie.
I thought you died alone a long, long time ago.
You know, Bowie, you know, always has his feelers out for what's next or what's going on or what's happening. And they got the call, and no one could believe it.
Who knows, not me, not him, man who sold the world.
I loved and shook his hand. So to get ready for Saturday Night Live, we said to Bowie, well, so what are you doing? What's going to happen? Are you going to do a staging? Are you doing costumes? What are you doing? And he said, yeah, and they're making me this copy of a Tristan Tzara design from some performance art piece from the 30s. So we look at this thing, and it's beautiful. I remember Pat Gibbons, who was Bowie's manager at the time. He comes up and he goes, well, you're going to have something. You're going to need some costumes. And he whips out a big wad of cash. And he goes, how much do you need? And he starts peeling off bills. And Joey and Klaus look at him, and their eyes widen, and they look at each other, and they go, we're going to need shoes, too.
I brought my baby home, and she sat around for lunch. She saw my TV suit on fire, baby, she's gone. She jumped by me, yeah. She jumped by me, yeah. So hot, I'm grabbing all my TV suit on fire.
Everyone was just had huge smiles on their faces, you know. Just we were just screaming, you know. It was just so insane.
That was like a wow. That's it. You know, he's on Saturday Night Live, and the day after we're going to play Madison Square Garden. They're just going to, you know, they'll fill the seats in no time flat. You know, you don't know. You know, you're 22 years old. This is your dream. Your boat's coming. You know, Klaus has made it, and we're all going.
So after Saturday Night Live, there was a party at 15th Avenue. And we went down there, and Bowie was sitting at a table with Tiny Tim and Iggy Pop. And I was talking to him, and I said, so what are your plans? Are you going to be in New York? Are you staying here? And he said, yeah, I've got a loft. I'm going to be around for a while. I have a couple of things I have to tie up, and then I'm free. And I said, well, we've got some ideas. And he goes, well, great. You'll be hearing from me. And Iggy Pop, who was smoking a big cigar, gave us the thumbs up. And we thought, great, we're in. But we never really heard from him again.
After the Bowie thing, you know, it just solidified in Klaus's mind and in Joey's mind that that was the way to go, you know, to be hyper-stylized, very, very distinctive. And it was just like, let's charge on with this. Let's charge on with it and just see how far we can take it.
When we saw this outfit that Bowie had custom made, we thought, well, we ought to have something on that level, too. So we went to Brooks Van Horn, which is the big theatrical supply place in New York. And I think the guy's name there was Jimmy, who was their main designer. And we said to him, look, we really like that thing you made for Bowie. Could you make something like that for us? And he looked at us and sort of said, well, that cost $1,500. So we took a big gulp. But he liked us. He liked what we were doing. And he said, well, look, I'll make something for you. And he made this great sort of stylized tuxedo.
You know, it was just this triangle, you know, and I was so into working with the square. He had thought this thing so deeply through, this whole concept of what Klaus Nomi was and what Klaus Nomi would do. You know, he did have a very powerful ego, and he did feel very much like he was responsible for all this stuff. You can let somebody else's powerful ego convince you that, you know, maybe you weren't really that much a part of it. Maybe it is all that costume design and makeup and, you know. At the same time, he wanted to see how much this character had. And so he was willing to kind of, you know, focus and concentrate and push that, all that into this. Drawing out the essence of Klaus Nomi in that image was just like, you know, it took everything I had because he was just fully there. And all I wanted to do was just make it as big as he was.
Tonight on our show, we have Klaus Nomi, the opera singing pastry chef. These are completely unrelated talents, and it just goes to show you that being a Renaissance person is on the rise again.
Okay, everybody ready for something sweet? I'm making something real sour. It's a lime tart. 1 1/4 cup graham cracker crumbs and 1/4 cup of melted butter. You mix it up, you know, and press them firm against the mold.
Separate the white from the...
This has to be whipped up till it's sort of... I combine this with the egg yolks, mix it up, add 1/2 cup of lemon juice, and which cooks this whole thing and makes it thick, and then I pour it into this shell.
How did you learn this art, Klaus? Or is it a craft?
Self-taught. As mostly everything that I'm doing. This is the lime tart, the finished product, decorated. This is the Linzer tart, made with butter, lots of butter, and lots of ground nuts and raspberry filling. This is the French dark croix, which is a hazelnut meringue, and this is a chocolate almond cake. It's very delicious.
I mean, I love those pies. They were like the most amazing things.
He used to bake his sweets and offer them to us, and
he was paying me with pies. you know, I could deliver so many prints to him, you know, that he would have to give me so many pies. I mean, we were literally like just, we got to the point where he had more than enough prints and I definitely had more than enough pies.
Klaus, by the way, is a new wave rock star who came to New York from Berlin.
He makes his chubby checker oldies and goodies, but goodies up with operatic arias, and they say he's the spookiest Tosca ever seen.
People thought he was like from another planet. He thought he was from another planet. We decided that we would use that as the entire shtick, that nobody would really know what a Klaus Nomi was or where he came from. And that was incredible. That tease created more of a market than I've ever seen in my life. They'd scream and they would yell and we would just leave them hanging every time we did this. It was awesome. And they'd want to find him and they'd want to go after him. It got to be nuts. It was a fanatic following. Brought him in with a limousine with a couple of guards. The show would end, he'd get off stage, we'd rush him into the car and leave. We would not touch anybody, no interviews, nothing. And that was his life.
Well, John, New York has always been the center of the avant-garde, but every so often, some artist or performer comes along who is so, well, out there that even the avant-garde sits up and takes notice. With his bizarre makeup and dreamlike movements, his Weimar tuxedo spaced out in future shock, this classically trained operatic tenor likes singing soprano falsetto arias in, of all places, rock clubs.
So, at one point, we were going to do a show at Harrah's. And in the local news, decided to do a little spot on us at 10 o'clock. Now, our first show at Harrah's was gonna go on at 11. Well, that gave people just enough time to get showered and get down there. So we show up in our limo, and there's a crowd of people crowding around the limo, hammering on the window. It's like the Beatles. 2,000 or 3,000 people in line around the block.
Klaus was on the news. I think that was the time when Klaus was with Bowie. Klaus had his face in every magazine. Klaus was in Japanese Vogue. Everybody was thinking like, Klaus is gonna get out of the East Village. He's going somewhere. This is a great thing to be attached to. And I fell prey to that too. I thought like, God, I'm finally in a situation where I might actually taste a little bit of success.
Involved with the creative side of the show. So that became little projects of building scenes, building sets, building costumes that reflected this particular song or that particular idea. Lightning Strikes Again should be not so much about the song, but about lightning.
Klaus would get the germ of an idea and he'd scribble it out on a napkin. And then my job was to take his little doodle and flesh it out and turn it into a reality. Now, one of the props we had was this thing, which we called the stockade, which is a part opera dress and part stockade. During the staging of Lightning Strikes, Janice and Joey would both come out with these parasols, and they had a whole choreography where it was a parasol for the rain. And then during the chorus, they'd hold them straight out and twirl them, and we'd get this lovely hypnotic effect.
It was the Tinker Toy version of the real opera show.
And that's what was great. There was this whole imagination thing going on. You wanted to be half robot, half, you know, painting. I don't know, we'd figure out a way to do it. No one ever said no.
You know, we'd meet at Klaus's place, and he'd have a Linzer Tort, and then he'd have a lemon icebox pie, and incredibly strong coffee. So we'd have our caffeine and sugar rush. And we'd just go out to the outer limits of our creativity and just have a blast doing it. You know, just have a blast. If we could have pulled off all of the ideas that we came up with, you know, it just would be amazing. It would still be going on, you know, into infinity.
After a while, we realized nothing was really happening. Everybody liked the show. Everyone was interested. I mean, this was a craze. This was just a big thing. But we couldn't get real record company executives interested in this. A lot of them thought it was too gay. They just thought it was a one-trick pony. Some of them even thought it was a trick. But we were getting all kinds of other people interested.
Through contacts that we meet at clubs, a lot of kids that were at clubs were musicians. They had their own bands. And we actually found a group that was from the Chicago area that was touring us. Oh, you got to get him out to the Midwest. They're going to love him. And we have management, and I'll tell you what, we can get him lined up. With that idea in mind, that became maybe a relief. Everybody in the Midwest fell in love with him. We were in Milwaukee, some amazing shows in Akron. We did two or three shows in Chicago. We did two shows in Minneapolis. We did an incredible show in Madison, Wisconsin.
Now, the severest test for us was New Jersey. And that was the days of the hair bands, the Jersey bands, who had played at these huge mall-like nightclubs. And thousands of people would come on a weekend. Twisted Sister had a gig one night, and Ron knew a couple of guys in the band, so we decided, why don't we open for Twisted Sister in the middle of New Jersey?
We're Twisted fucking Sister!
The club was only about 2 miles from the George Washington Bridge. So if you're in New York City, you're 2 miles geographically from Manhattan. But culturally, you were 8 million miles away as far as these kids were concerned. They had no desire to see a performance artist do anything truly bizarre. Before he went on, I went in the dressing room and introduced myself. And because I didn't know what it was about, and I expected, you know, that nod, nod, wink, wink, you know, like, hey, man, we're all in this together. And I didn't get that. I got a serious artist, and I went, ooh, you know, okay, good luck. Like, this was New York City performance art done in a blue-collar suburban bar.
It was horrifying, and we realized then, well, maybe all of the world isn't quite ready for him yet. Klaus didn't speak to us for a couple of days after that, but he eventually got over it.
Falling in love again, never wanted to. What am I to do?
Everyone was a freak, but he was a freak among the freaks. But at the same time, he was a human being as well, and I think he longed to have, you know, a boyfriend, a relationship, more like love. I remember one time he was with me, and he really wanted me to be his boyfriend, and I felt really bad because I adored Klaus in every way, but he was...
So many times I blunder. In love and out again.
He
think he did sleep over one night in my apartment. I remember feeling so freaked out the next day, like, oh my God, what did I just do?
They offer me devotion. I like it, I confess.
You know, and I'd see him in some cruising areas sometimes down at the piers. You know, he was just doing it. Turning around the corner, Klaus. Not only did I, ooh, Klaus, but Klaus. Like, ooh.
When I reflect emotion, there's no need to guess.
We had a little bit of falling out because I tried to remind him that you cannot really gamble with your health like that. But he thought penicillin would be like a cure for all and pop it before you go to the trucks.
Ich bin von Kopf bis Fuß auf Liebe eingestellt. Ja, das ist meine Welt. Und das war was. Ich kann, was soll ich machen? Ja, doch Liebe nur. Ja, das ist meine Natur. Und das gar nicht. Leute, ich werd mich wie die Motten. Das ist recht. Aber wenn sie verbrennen, ja, dafür kann ich nicht. Ich bin von Kopf bis Fuß auf Liebe eingestellt. Ja, das ist meine Welt und das gar nicht.
The whole time just seemed so immediate and fun. It's hard to describe how little thought I gave any of this. It just one sort of like epiphany happened after another.
Well, now I do a lot of shows. I get a lot of response from club owners. When can we get Klaus? How much is it going to cost? It's great. Can you do it on this day? Well, we parlayed that for most of the summer and really worked the act out. And it was fun. I mean, it was a lot of fun doing it. It was a lot of work. In the meantime, you were witnessing one of the loneliest persons on the earth.
Times were not as difficult as they are now, so, you know, maintaining an apartment or having little odd jobs here and there was much easier, and things weren't that expensive, so I don't think he really suffered financially before. Once he was making music and he became Nomi, it wasn't that easy anymore to bake cake and maintain a living. And I think he was poorer than before. Yeah, because he had to also have a whole image.
I think a lot of us saw that Klaus was unhappy too, you know. There was a very fragile side of Klaus. And he didn't show a lot of emotion, but you could tell when he was unhappy and frustrated.
We thought we would, within a certain scope of time, would have a tremendous deal going for him. We didn't need other people. We knew better than other people what we wanted and what Klaus needed. Klaus maybe recognized that, but denied it. I mean, he decided that there may be other people out there could do more for him.
The suspicions that everyone has, do these guys really know what they're doing?
Well, no, we didn't know what we were doing, but we were there. We were doing this. No one else was. No one else was coming in. No one else was paying the bills, getting gigs together. So he was really kind of stuck with us, and he realized that. So he'd vacillate between going along with what we told him he should be doing and flipping out and saying, you guys don't know what you're doing. I should be famous already by now. Nothing was happening fast enough for him.
It just seemed that it wasn't cash in his pocket. It was just enough to keep him in his costumes and food and pay his rent. So we succumbed to a financial situation with a venture capitalist who had money. He didn't know anything about the music. He didn't know anything about Klaus. It was purely a financial situation that he saw. And I guaranteed the fact that I could do a showcase type of album if that's what we needed to get his involvement. He said, I need some product. I need something to hang on to.
Every story of every rock band, if you ever watch those MTV Behind the Musics, it's always the same thing. Everybody sells their life away in a bad recording contract, and they spend the next 5 years trying to get out of it. Well, of course, Klaus did the same thing. He signed a contract with Spin Dizzy that he didn't really look at, and he signed away a lot more than he probably should have.
And somewhere in between then, there came a negotiation where Ron Johnson, or whoever it was, decided the band was really bad.
Eventually, I convinced Klaus, and he agreed, that he wanted to do more of a professionally, musically adapted record.
So Ron hired some friends of his, basically, to do the tracks. And these guys were professional musicians, and they played everything really well, which was, for me, was part of the problem.
Ron was trying to take a freak show and make it digestible to the American public.
Our original show, as we presented it, we thought that it should have been done as is. Ron and the record people had a different idea, and it just got to be too much for me.
I don't remember specifically ever being fired from the band, but, you know, suddenly I was just not in the picture anymore.
I really wanted to put creatively into Klaus with more music. And as the group came together, there was less and less space for that, so I kind of moved out of it.
It became a lot bigger than I think what, you know, everyone had been used to. So obviously there was a feeling of, you know, of disappointment. You know, that, you know, you are replaceable in the world of Nomi.
We ended up with a showcase album that really wasn't the Klaus Nomi theme or the Klaus Nomi feeling or his intrigue, but it did show him able to sing to real music. I got a call from Miles Copeland saying, you know, we think that your band is the type of band that we would like to have in this movie they were shooting, Erg, A Music War. So for a few weeks, we got into a rehearsal studio and decided that we could work up an act with a live band. And basically what we did was work on a couple of songs that they wanted us to do for the movie. And we put a show on for that movie.
Someone called, we are all out, turning into French fries.
I hired a choreographer, and we got a couple of girls who could dance and do some like very avant-garde dancing.
The show that we saw had some girls in tight leotards doing very choreographed Joffrey ballet kind of moves. The whole band is up there, and like with their long hair in their faces and their big belt buckles, and doing a 70s arena rock thing, and we didn't think that was right. That just wasn't modern. Our show was really had a beginning, middle, and an end, and it all hung together, and it all kind of made sense. When we saw the Erg production, it was just it was a rock band. It was a rock band playing songs. It was still great. Anything he did, all he had to do was show up, and it was great. But it did lose our original concept.
It wasn't Nomi World anymore. But I think that was okay. He was already sort of detaching himself and hopefully floating off to bigger and better things. But he was so unusual. He was so unusual that if you weren't there from the beginning, if you didn't know him that well, you didn't really know.
The whole concept at that point started changing into a whole kind of business deal that had no regards for what Klaus Nomi was, where he was coming from, who he was involved with, and where his market was in the United States. It became nothing more than a negotiating point for money and for a record deal that started and ended in France.
They saw my face, would I still take a vow? Will they know me now. We
fell in love with the project because we saw potential there. We never knew it would become that big. You never know that in the beginning anyway. But we felt, you know, this was our job to make sure that we worked with this guy. It's interesting because we thought, as a record company, that the pop songs or the more top 40 kind of songs would pick up easier. And it's actually the classical songs that got the most attention. And that's when he took off. The record company executives were like, listen, what, you know, we don't know what to do with this. I mean, we don't even know where to rack it in the stores. You know, where do you put a Klaus Nomi? Is he in a classical bin? Do you put him in the pop section? Do you put him, he had everybody. He had the kids, who really liked the fact that he was of the war. And then you had the classical people who totally respected the interpretation of the arias. They found it actually very cool. And then you had the cutting edge fashion people, and you know, it became, you have to have that record. We end up doing a huge show at the Palace, which was the big club. The entire fashion community showed up because they were absolutely intrigued by the look. And downstairs was this huge restaurant. And I remember we did the show and then we had a dinner downstairs. We couldn't even get to the table. It was just everybody who was who's what in Paris and the, you know, the was there at the restaurant, wanted to meet him. We never expected that there was a situation where you needed security or anything like that. But we got followed to the restaurants and, you know, people on these autographs. It was just nuts. And there was a bunch of paparazzis. We could not actually believe that it would generate that kind of interest. We were out of stock within a week. He had bloomed into a serious artist for the record company. Now that, you know, RCA Records US would call and try to find out, you know, the weekly sales. My company, who didn't really believe him at the beginning and let the record go out of stock very fast, all of a sudden wanted a new album by next year. Meanwhile, I also had to take him on the road in Europe because the record now had gone, you know, over the frontiers, and the UK wanted him, Germany wanted him.
Meine Damen und Herren. Das war jetzt kein Trick oder sowas, oder das waren auch keine technischen Spielereien. Es war wirklich die Originalstimme von Klaus Nomi live und hier im Studio. Und ich darf ihn jetzt bei mir begrüßen, Klaus Nomi. Klaus, darf ich dir das gleich geben? Gut geht's, bitteschön. Jetzt bin ich auch so einer von den Talkmastern mit den richtigen Talkstühlen.
Vielen Dank.
Oh, der Bürzel hindert. Darf ich vielleicht?
Ich habe ein Problem.
So.
Okay.
So, schön. Aber schöne Beine hat er auch, hä? Klaus.
Danke.
Mezzosopran ist was ganz.
Dann bin ich ja aus allen Wolken gefallen, als ich dann das von Klaus Nomi hörte und das dann in der Verkleidung im Fernsehen gesehen habe. Da habe ich mit meinem Freundeskreis hier zusammengesessen und da haben die auf einmal alle gesagt, ja, was hat der denn jetzt für eine Sache angenommen? So kennen wir ihn ja alle gar nicht, ne?
Danke, Klaus. Also, es ist richtig toll. Ich glaube, der Bio ist etwas neidisch. Ich hoffe es zumindest, aber wir haben ihn entdeckt. Klaus Nomi und Total Eclipse.
Big Shots are here.
Ob das vielleicht jetzt auch aus finanziellen Gründen, um sich über Wasser zu halten, kann ich mir aber nicht vorstellen. Denn er hat das ja so perfekt auf der Bühne dargestellt, dass das eigentlich nicht nur so etwas war, was er so aus Verlegenheit gemacht hätte. Aber dass es sein Lebenstraum war, nur das zu machen, das habe ich mir nie vorstellen können. Und nicht nur ich, sondern auch so sein ganzer Kreis von hier. Aber Klaus hat sich in seinem Wesen im Grunde genommen für mich nie verändert. Ob er da drüben dies, jenes oder das gemacht hat, wenn der Junge kam, dann war es so, als wenn der nie weg gewesen wäre. Also er hatte mir gegenüber nie Allüren angenommen, irgendwelche Star-Allüren oder so etwas. Da ist er eigentlich ganz der Alte geblieben.
Klaus Nomi, stark, hä?
So then I was in Europe and I was walking down the street in Holland and there suddenly was the Klaus Nomi album. And it was exciting, and I looked at it in the store, and it actually had my name on it, but it had none of my publishing information. They had given my songs to some publisher I'd never heard of. They didn't give me the courtesy of a phone call to say this is happening, or try to send me a copy, or... So, at once, I was on RCA, I had my two songs on a real record and an album in a store with Klaus, who I thought was fabulous, and I also had been abandoned, you know, stabbed in the back, blah, 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 whatever feelings you would tend to feel at that moment. So I didn't hear from Klaus for quite some time, and then I got this phone call that said, we are recording a second album for Klaus. Would you like to participate? And I just found this so outlandish, but I thought, like, well, I'm not going to say anything. I'll just go and meet with them and see what they have to say. And I was ready to be seduced in as much as that. I had songs I'd written for Klaus that I thought were the best songs I'd ever written for him, but I was very careful not to do anything stupid to lead further into the trap I'd been led into by the first album. And then I went into these recording sessions. Creatively, it was fantastic. We made fabulous recordings of Simple Man and After the Fall. Like, Klaus's voice was fantastic. He sang beautiful harmonies with himself. And they used my song as the title song of the album. It was like, it was heaven. And then the exact same thing happened. It was like, that came out in France. They didn't put my publishing name on the record. They put somebody else's name on it. I never got any money from it. And that's what happened. So I didn't speak to Klaus again until he was on his deathbed.
I'm just a simple man, man. I have to do the simple things that a simple man can.
It happened probably the next weekend after the Simple Man video had been filmed. And it was really a celebration evening. It was an evening to sort of celebrate the finishing of the video, and it was an anticipated send-off to going on tour in Europe, a Simple Man show. So it was a great moment of triumph for Klaus. His career was going where he wanted it to. He was on his home turf, he was on his home club.
It was purely an event. It was almost like going to a boxing match. I remember the lighting that night, it felt like a boxing match. You know, and there was just this bluish-white glow on Klaus. He had such a following at that point. The place was packed. And, you know, there was a lot of expectation. He had worn himself down, and he had a heinous cold, and he was getting shots to bring his voice back. And the musicians were definitely sort of leading the show, you know, in a very, 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 very fast direction. You know, number one, to get through it, and number two, probably because Klaus, wasn't holding the notes as long as he should, and he wasn't.
Love, love is just a simple thought, a little bit the worse for wear like a thief who got.
It was really a great evening. Now, as to the specifics of the show, they're a mystery to me. I know it was a great evening. I know I had a great time. I know who I was there with. And it was a huge amount of fun. But I think that Klaus was very on that night. It was a very exciting evening.
I remember looking at one point and seeing that a look on Klaus's face, right? At one moment, it was sheer terror, right? And then I know Joey was being really, Joey just started cutting loose that night. I remember that at one point Klaus just lit up and like started laughing, like in the middle of the performance. Sort of like, you know, the fun, loose elements of what he left behind were sort of on stage that night also. And it was probably a survival tactic, you know? He got through it. The place was just so electric and so crowded that it felt like a success, you know? And he literally almost collapsed when it was over.
It should have been a great and glorious future. And I suppose many of us maybe have repressed the specifics of the show because the fact that it was a great and glorious end and not a great and glorious future was unknowable at that time. We really thought this was the beginning, not the end.
I do the best I can. I got a simple, simple plan. I hope you understand. I'm just a simple man.
I'm simple.
I'm holding out my hand. It's such a simple, simple plan. I think you understand.
You're so simple, man.
We had a clear plan. I mean, we were going to tour Europe and then try to see how we can do in America. Management didn't want to spend any money. When you tour an artist like Klaus Nomi, it is what you call a tour support. And management was absolutely not interested in doing that at all. You know, they wanted to sell records and get their cut and leave.
When they tried to promote the second album, Klaus went out on promotional tours by himself.
And he went to Europe, and then he got really ill. He was taking a massive amount of antibiotics and always getting these shots to bring his voice back. You know, I was like, Klaus, you've got to, He's like, but I gotta keep going,
Ein halbes Jahr vorher ist Klaus noch mal hier in Essen gewesen und hatte in Paris die goldene Schallplatte bekommen. Und da hat er mich hier besucht und da habe ich ihm seine Lieblingsspeise gekocht. Das war eine selbstgemachte Sülze. Da hat er immer so für geschwärmt. Und da habe ich gedacht, das machst du jetzt, wenn er kommt. Ne? Und dann haben wir hier sehr schöne Stunden verbracht. Und dann ist er mit mir noch mal hier vorne rausgegangen in den Beiweg. Da habe ich 35 Jahre mit meinem Mann gewohnt. Und Klaus hat sehr viele schöne Stunden bei uns verlebt. Der Garten war dabei. Dann kam er, wie er noch jünger war, von der Schule aus schon zu uns. Dann haben wir Mittag gegessen, weil die Mutti ja arbeitete. Und da sagte er denn kurz bevor er gehen musste, kannst du mir mal einen Gefallen tun, Tante Dodo? Ich möchte mit dir noch einmal durch den Beiweg gehen und in den Garten schauen, wo ich so herrliche Stunden verlebt habe. Und da fand ich das so, das hörte sich so wie Abschied an. Ja, sag ich, selbstverständlich machen wir das. Es war auch ein schöner Tag draußen. Und da bin ich mit ihm noch mal da durchgegangen. Er hat noch mal in den Garten geschaut und freute sich. Und dann hat er sich von mir sehr herzlich verabschiedet. Und da habe ich mir sehr viel Gedanken drüber gemacht. Ja, hinterher konnte ich mir das alles erklären. Da war das wirklich unser Abschied für immer dann. Und da hatte er diese Krankheit schon und wusste es und hat es uns gar nicht erzählt.
So after Klaus came back from Europe, and he was sick, we realized that this was terminal, that he wasn't going to recover from this, and it really was all over. And I remember seeing him at a dinner, and usually I'd go over and give Klaus a hug and give him a European kiss on each cheek, and I was just afraid to. I didn't know if this was contagious or what would happen, and I sort of came up to him and I hesitated, and he just put his hand on me and went, it's all right, don't worry about it, which really made me start to tear up. And I think that was the last time I saw him.
What power art thou who throw upon me?
On the phone with Klaus. He had called me from the hospital at 11 o'clock. Channel 4 News was on. You know, it was like the lead story on this gay cancer. And they were describing it. And Klaus, that day, had discovered some bumps or lesions on his skin. And, you know, everything was so new. The disease was so new. And he was, right at that moment, right, we were both watching the news at the same time. He was in the hospital, I was at my apartment. And he was like, oh my God, I have these. I have this on my arm. What is it? I have it.
AIDS was so new, and it was kind of like you had been given your death sentence if they said that to you, and they called it gay cancer, and the words are so ugly together, and here he was in the hospital, and I just kept thinking, like, I loved him and I felt bad for him, but I'm the person that he, through whatever reasoning of his own, fucked over and left behind, and he's calling me. And in retrospect, I think he probably just was lying there crying and on the phone with whoever would answer the phone.
And a lot of people took off. They didn't know how to deal with it. I didn't know how to deal with it. Is it something I can catch? Does he have, you know, typhoid or the plague? Is this what this is? And you heard rumors, you heard stuff through the underground. You weren't sure what was going on.
The party was over, and now it was about surviving, you know? And it was terrible. It was a real sad, sad time. And I never ever dreamed that I'd be, you know, even though we used to make fun, oh, where the bomb's gonna go off tomorrow, we didn't really think it was gonna go off, you know? We'd like to pretend it was, but we didn't really think it was. And then it actually did.
Well, he didn't leave a very good-looking corpse. If there would have been a corpse. Quite the contrary. You know, and that brings me back to my anger. I haven't yet listened to his music again. I just can't. Because I was so angry.
Went to the hospital. I didn't want to go. I just didn't want to see him there. I wanted to remember him the way he was. So I didn't go.
As much as I was moved and shared Klaus's anguish over what was happening to him, I was too afraid to go visit him in the hospital.
I wish that I had been there for him in his last days, but all I can say was that I, along with a lot of other people, were in denial, and I just couldn't deal with someone dying. Never had that in my life.
It was definitely, a very dramatic ending, and you know, you don't want to say that it was appropriate, but, it was, at the time, it was extremely surprising. But now, thinking about it, it's a perfect, you know, sort of like a perfect coda to everything. It was just like, wow, okay. You know, it's like the end of like this, you know, this crazy, lavish opera in a way.
us now turn back the clock to opening night at the Irving Plaza, the New Wave Vaudeville Show, when I, your master of ceremony, David Walter McDermott III, introduce Klaus Nomi for the very first time ever.
Some kind of very swell affair. And it was sort of midtown, uptown, and it was in the basement of some very grand place, I remember. And there were some very highfalutin characters there. A lot of makeup and some very grand dresses. And, you know, the downtown crowd. And suddenly in the middle of it was Klaus Nomi. And I went there with my girlfriend and her daughter, who was six. Her name was Rebecca, in her little frilly frock, and she was staying up late and having fun. And Klaus Nomi was like done to the nines. He really looked like a Sunday going to Martian church outfit. I think it was kind of metallic. I sort of remember it was gold and silver or something. And he was standing there in a kind of little cocoon of his own, because nobody could go up to somebody who looked like this and say, yeah, you know, hi, how you doing? How about them Mets, you know? I mean, he was totally unapproachable. And Rebecca, this little girl, just went over to him. And just like said, hi, are you from outer space? And he said, yes, yes I am, as a matter of fact. And they just sat down together and they had this lovely little conversation. And she was, you know, asking him these questions like, well, what's it like on Mars? You know, and what's the weather like? And, you know, and he was just answering in the nicest possible way. And people were just staring at them. And it was like a little couple of old ladies just sitting down there nattering about, you know, the weather. But it was all about on Mars, and it was kind of so nice, so sweet. And everybody was like, again, it was very affecting. He was just a very affecting little guy, you know, with who made an incredible impression on people. Then he was gone.
Good job?
No, just for now. It wasn't the right time for us to meet. But there'll be other nights, other stars for us to watch. They'll be back.
Caught you unaware.
grown.